section of electromagnetic spectrum. We're all familiar with that, but it's just fun to see how small of an area it covers. And there's, so what we're looking at is the Fraunhofer lines, the absorption lines, and these are some that represent some of the elements. I have a chart that, if you had a question, which later indicated what element I could tell you. But we're fairly familiar with what part of the spectrum range you're looking at with the solar telescopes. And who invented the spectrohelioscope? George Hilary Dale. And he invented it in 1924. He wanted to see the sun in real time. And they used to make spectrographs of the sun, spectroheliographs it's sometimes called. And many of you are probably familiar with the three volumes of the telescope made. And that's where I kind of got the idea I'm interested in maybe building one, looking at the sun. So this was an illustration in the book. And George Hilary Dale had this, I think this is probably his first design, and he used oscillating slits that went back and forth. He had a stereostat, this in. He had it in a garage, actually, and he had a lens, and the light went from the stereostat through an entrance slit over here and down. To a mirror, then back, a bit of grating, back to the other mirror, and came back through the entrance. So,
what's it hitting first?
Pardon?
What's it hitting first? The mirror, right?
Well, this is a stereostat. The sun comes down here. Well, the sun hits this, goes back up, hits this mirror, and goes through the lens, and it's focused, the image is focused on the entrance. So, same thing happens with this one, basically, except it's an all mirror system. This is a top view, so you can kind of see the light path through the top view. This is the stereostat arrangement outside this garage. Now, kind of remember how this looks, if you're going to see it again. And, but this is how it looked at the time he was using the instrument. Okay, I already mentioned, I read about spectrohelioscope in the book, but the way it used large cement piers and all the heavy structure to keep it from vibrating or to keep everything in line, it seemed kind of difficult. I met Fred in the early 80s, we had a star party, and I mentioned this to him, and then he started talking about spectrohelioscopes. He had written a book on spectrohelioscopes. So this is Fred on the right, and I'm on the left. And I've had it together for a while, and we would set it up in my backyard, and Fred would come down, and we'd look through it, and he would take notes. I'm not a very good scientist as far as reporting things, using it for later, but he is. He was good at that. And then he kept finding more things that we could search for with this instrument, because it had such a good dispersion of the spectrum. You can see some detail in the spectral lines. This is the current light path of this instrument. So we have the sun up here. This is a stereostat, has two mirrors. This mirror rotates once every 48 hours. When you reflect an object onto another mirror, and you move the mirror that's reflecting the object onto it. The light moves, or the image moves twice the speed that the move does. So you have to gear it down. Yeah.
We can't see you pointing at the screen, you have to point at the battery.
Oh, okay. There you go. Thank you. Well, I'm an amateur.
Thank you.
So, okay. And then, I didn't move this down here, but then the light from the second mirror goes to the telescope, which was here. The light from the telescope mirror comes down and it goes into this diagonal. And from there it goes down inside the box. It hits a mirror that's on an aluminum plate. The aluminum plate has two mirrors on it. That's long. And the light goes down, hits this mirror, and then it goes that way. And it goes into an entrance slit, which you can see here. At the back of the box, down at the far end inside, is an 8-inch diameter mirror. It's an F11. Used to go to a sheep's big light telescope. A friend of mine gave it to me. Okay, that's an 8-inch mirror, and in front of it is a mask. And the mask has two circular holes in it. So it acts like two mirrors. So the light hits the outer mirror, goes to the entrance slit, hits this side. And it comes back down the box as parallel light. It's not focused light, it's just parallel. And it hits the diffraction grating. This is the diffraction grating. It has 1200 lines per millimeter, it's a 2-inch square. And then it goes back to the other side of the mirror. It goes on that side, and it's still parallel light. Then it comes back through either an exit slit or just an opening. And I'll show you how that works here, but it goes through an opening. If I have the exit slit there, I would use this instrument to look at the disk at the center. I could move the exit slit out of the way, and I could look at the spectrum at the center. I'll explain later how that works. Well, then the eyepiece arrangement I have here, it's a 45 degree prism arrangement. I guess they call it a directing prism. But I had a little objective lenses on either side to make like a relay lens to get the image from the slit up through the optics so you can see it. The image is actually about 8 inches away. So I have to focus to that distance. And then the eye relief is so great that I had to make an extension with a round hole in it so you can get your eye in the right spot, otherwise you have a hard time getting your eye in where the very disc is. This way would fall. We'll go on. I have some videos here I'll show you. I had a simple little heliostat here. In fact, it's the mirror that's inside this now. I had it aluminized. A friend of mine gave it to me. This is about a 3 1/4 lens that I had. It was an F12 refractor. This is the first design, just to see if it was going to work. It wasn't really sure. Of course, Fred was helping me with it also. Okay, these are, I just had it set up in the backyard with one of the stands that you see here, just a bench and some wood to hold it up. And you can see how small the diagonal was that goes down inside over here. This looks like a stovepipe. But I was having a hard time focusing it, so I was just not an optical person, so I was experimenting. And then I had, for telling the diffraction grade, I used a micrometer. As you can see a little housing here. I have some more pictures of it. Anyway, this is, oh, and you see right here, that's the disk of the sun. It's about 3/8 of an inch in diameter, because the focal length of the lens is not very long. Okay, this is the side view. And here you can see the where I tilted the diffraction grating. There is an arm that went down in here and tilted it. So these are the early stages, and this is an electric core that went in to operate the naughty measures. We'll get there. This is another picture. I had a handle on it. And the wood wasn't cut. You can see how I had the wood cut back on this one. So I've made modifications over the years. And I just probably go through this again, but the sun hits this, goes through here, and goes down through the diagonal, and back to the entrance. So I have to do this fairly quick. Okay, this is the naughty mirror synthesizer. So this is the aluminum plate, and this is an elliptical mirror like you use in the diagonal, that's what they are. And I drilled, made some holes in it to make it lighter. I put some weight up here to balance it. This is an arm that comes out. And this is just an electric motor. And I made an eccentric wheel. And I use a whole set of ignition points that have fiber on it to ride up and down on this wheel. So this only moves maybe 1/8 of an inch, one way or the other. And so it's making the beam move back and forth over the entrance. So this is for running it to see the disk of the sun. And this is a close-up of the wheel. I drilled some holes in it because more of the metal was on that side. I wanted it to be somewhat balanced, so I did that. I put a great big capacitor on there to keep the to the earth, or keep it last longer. And it's just spring like holds it down. I was able to make some adjustments here. You have to make everything adjustable. This is how it looks inside the box. So this is, the light comes down, hits that, goes to the entrance. So on that side's the diagonal mirror where the light comes out of the, that's the entrance, comes out of the exit slit into the eyepiece. This is a great big piece of steel. It's worried about vibration. It's rubber biscuits and stuff to keep the vibration down. But that hasn't been an issue. Okay, now this is when somebody used to kid me about this. What are you cooking here? You know, it's like, okay, it's almost done. But you have to get to everything, and you have to make adjustments. And so those are just access points. But I made the, well, you'll see better pictures of this. But I made the adjustable slits, made them out of a stainless steel. This is looking inside. I used to have what was called an image shifter. It's just a piece of glass, but it acted, it allowed you to bend the light a little bit when you turned it. But I had a heliostat, and it didn't always track real good, so this allowed you to try to keep the, what you're looking at in view a little bit longer. Then I have a red filter over here, because some of the diffraction grating has different they have overlapping of different orders, first order, second order, third order. So first order spreads out so far, second order about twice as far. But there's some overlap. So this took care of the overlap of hydrogen alpha. Well, that's going up to the eyepiece there, and coming down would be going into the diagonal. But you can kind of see how it looks inside. This is a close-up of the exit slit arrangement. And you can see I have a hinge over here. The exit slip system is here. This tapered cone, when you screw that in there, pushes those two things apart and spreads the slits apart like this, evenly. See why? You want to keep it the light all in the same axis. Now, if I wanted to look at the spectrum, I just move that out of the way, like the door. And that was just a little knob to allow me to swing it out. So it was an easy way to put the exit slit in. And this is down at Hale Solar Lab. I set it up down there. This is the pictures of that. It's a friend, Norm Case, looking at the Ebert mirror that's inside. It's inside that box. And then behind it, there's an electric motor system. And so you can move it back and forth, because you have to focus it sometimes. But using an all mirror system, everything, you know, all the colors of the light are focused in the same place. You don't have chromatic aberration. And then you adjust it. I have another screw down there. It's like you would any mirror in a telescope. This is the long box. There's nothing in it. It's just empty. I had to cut it to bring it here, so you could see this funny looking little section. I had to cut that much. I cut a section out, then I had to make it so I could put it back in. So I went to a little extra work to make it more portable. So I kind of hated cutting through it. You know, so I never did that. But it's okay. And this is looking down. I have a baffle here in the center. It doesn't go the whole length of the box, but part of it. This is a diffraction grade. And this is the older, a little older style, how it rotated. It's still basically the same. But then you have to tilt and move it. That's the exit port. The entrance port is over here. Okay, the door of the exit section is open, so you can see how that looks. Fold it in out. This is the heliostat system. Like you see it now. And it's only about 2 years that I've used it. The first year I've used it with it being able to be clamped, probably with that a little better. Okay, this is mirrored in there. Comes back, that's the telescope part of it. And I also had made, used plano concave optics to extend the focal length. Because sometimes I wanted the image of the sun to be larger, so the sunspots section would be you'd be able to get it on the entrance, so it sees in detail. You really need to hurry, because I have some videos. I want you to see it. Then the eyepiece image. You do it. This is Fred Veal over here. I forgot his name. That's Don Nicholson. Don Nicholson's father is Seth Nicholson. Seth Nicholson worked with George Hillary Hale on Sunspot. And Don is now, he was born in 1918, so he's 98 years old. And he's still alive. And that's. You have to have some electrical power for it. So there's a lot of electric motors that have to be used. You could, when you move the diffraction gradient, you want to move it slowly so you can get the spectral line you want to use to look at this. You want to get it in view. So I just made a little gear arrangement. And I just used this gear arrangement. And I used just a threading tab and did what they call popping, fed it into the tab rotating. I didn't really care how many threads. Just wanted to make it so it would be geared down. And then you can pull it down if you want to move it quickly. This is Fred Veal, Riverside. I took him down there one time. So we did that. He'd have the chance. He went there many years ago. And it was nice for him to be able to come down again. This is Hydrogen Alpha. If you look at it visually in person, looks a little better, but I took this with just a handheld in color. But everything you see with your eye through it. These are sodium lines. They're very dark. D1, D2. There's some lines. You see a lot of detail in this. It really spreads the spectrum out quite a ways because of the long focal length. This is helium in emission. And to get that, you have to get the disk of the sun, the edge of it, the limb, right on the edge of the slits. Because the helium is in the chromosphere area, I believe. Those of you that are experts could explain it better. But it's kind of hard to do. And sometimes, especially if you have a small disk on the slit, spectrohelioscope. So this is kind of fun. And they discovered helium on the sun before they did it. I have some other videos of helium. These are magnesium lines down in the green. I put the wavelengths up here and see what they are. This is H beta down in the blue. This is H and K calcium. And you can see how broad the area is. You can see the little bright areas going through. These are sunspots. This horizontal line, you can see the penumbra area, the umbra, and sometimes there'll be light lines going across, could be large hot areas. Like I said, I have videos. This is a camera that I use to go through this quickly. This is H alpha in the second order. So then I was using one of the focal extenders to be able to get the sunspot. That's a sunspot going through there. Those lines going through here. The hot collage, you can see what it does. That's just going down. But it makes openings. And then a lot of times, when you see this angle right here, that's probably a filament. And if it's off, then it's a Doppler shift. If you knew how far part of an action that is, then there's formulas you could use to tell the velocity of it. So you see some of the dynamics that go on. This is probably done in year 2000, somewhere around there, when the sun is really active. There's a lot of magnetic areas. Now, I never thought I'd ever see this with this instrument, but that's the Zeeman split. And that's down in the magnesium area, the green area. And I found a line down there that looked really neat, and it's this. See how it's bowed out, you can see a little space in between there. And how do you know where you are? Well, you have some charts and things that you could use. You see some of that. This is off the spectrum of the sun. And this is the spectrum, but it's overexposed. this is what you see. The hydrogen alpha line is down here. And at the edge of the spectrum, open space, this is coming off. And you can see how it's zigzagging. And when you're moving the image of the sun over the entrance slit, you see this line moving around like a flame. And you'll see parts of it going different directions. And those are delta shapes. So it's, it has velocity in different directions. That's another one coming off the spectrum. So you don't need to even have a dotting mirror, or you could just see it off the spectrum. Some more. There's quite a Doppler shift here, going way off. I saw one through the eyepiece of the, and it was beyond the field of view. It was a spray, I think, coming off the sun. But here it is on both sides. This is a sunspot. This is also another. They're not all the same density, but there's some pen over here. And a lot of it, of course, I'm using a video camera, and so sometimes you could adjust the gain a little, you know, not quite correct. But you know, these are the things that happen. This is sodium, but you can see over here a little bright spot. That's where helium is. That's a little bit of helium in emission. This is just done off a monitor. I just put it in there. But look at all the, see the hydrogen alpha line is not smooth. You see all this jagged stuff along here. That's Doppler shifting. The cells, the granulation, rise and falling. And you're seeing this. It looks like a snake when you're moving the disk of the sun over the entrance. This thing just wiggles. You see dark areas, light areas. It's just, to me, it's pretty exciting because you're watching the physics going on. And I just use a VCR recorder. And a little CRT thing, there's a camera there, and I would put it on there. Here's Zeeman split again. Now this is in color. I took it with my handheld camera. I think it's this one. You could see a little bit of green in between. This is a profile chart, so you use charts to tell where you are, to identify the lines, the angstrom. This is a chart that shows the absorption lines. So I have some up here. Top of the spectroscope box. This is a book that you could use to, and it tells you what all these lines are, most of them. So if you know where it is on the spectrum, you could look at that and you can tell, what it, find out what it is. And this is the favorite line I like to look for here. It really is sensitive to the magnetic field. Here's Don Nicholson, Fred, you're looking through the charts. You could spend all day just looking at one aspect of this. And looking at the spectrum itself and what's going on, it's fascinating. The dish part is interesting too, but I enjoy looking at the spectrum the most. But there's, oh, it's the Venus transit. I just did it for the fun of it. Just a dark line, that's all it is. It goes across the whole spectrum. So, now here's when the nodding mirror is running, and you have hydrogen alpha behind there, that's what the sun looks like through this instrument. And then it looks like looking through a door. And you're moving the disk, you're moving the disk of the image of the disk of the sun on the entrance slit. Behind it, you see the sun's moving behind the door, moving back and down, back and forth. I have some videos of that. So I'm not going to go through this because it's not a really some of this, but I'm not going to do that. Okay. I won't talk during this. I made this last too long. Okay, this is calcium. I don't know whether it's H or K calcium. I really can't tell the difference. They look exactly the same to me when you look through them. Might be a slight difference. But the nodding, you don't see this that way when you're looking. Well, I can't see calcium with H or K with my eyes visually. I can only do it with the camera. Our eyes are not sensitive. Maybe a really young person with real good eyes can see that far. The spectrohelioscopes do not make real bright images while well, they do in the spectrum, but not when you operate it to see the disk. So what I was doing here was just going over the whole disk of the sun. And I was just doing this for the fun of it, for me. I never was planning on showing this to anybody, but since I was asked, Jen invited me to come here, so I thought, I better do something like that. as I had dig through a bunch of videos, I did find some that might be suitable. But after a while, I'll change it to hydrogen alpha, and you'll see the difference. And it's, you know, maybe it could be focused there. There's always something you can do to make it better. But this, to be able to do this, just mechanically, with the same, right, you know, nodding back and forth. And what it does is it leaves a latent image in front of your eye, like watching an old movie. And it's actually, it's flickering about 30 times a second. But the video cameras aren't synchronized to this. So it's the synchronization that gives this weird kind of appearance to it. So we'll look at these. And if it's taken too long, I could just go to the next one. But this was kind of interesting. Now we're in hydrogen alpha. And that's a filament that's up here, right in there. Very dark, a lot of contrast. You may not see that much contrast visually, but with the camera, you know, you could adjust these things somewhat. And when it starts, sometimes it starts to get synchronized pretty good. And it'll go back and forth slow. Other times it goes different speed. So what I'm doing, I'm using up just the heliostat at this stage of the spectrohelioscope. So I reach up and I grab it and I move it around. But that's what this instrument can do. I was looking at a filament yesterday when the sun was before the clouds came in. It's supposed to be a portable instrument, but it's almost getting beyond being portable. Sure keeps me going. You know, I've taken that thing apart and put it back together so many times. And I keep modifying it here and there. And there's so many things you have to think about that might get out of adjustment, and some things do. So it took me a while to get it going again. It's the astronomy isn't a fun hobby, it sure it gets to you. I never thought I would get so involved. Now that's a prominence. Did you see that little part up there? Yeah. So, you know, if you overexpose the sun, then you can start seeing some of these prominences. But to tune that, you know, what's going on is you close the exit slit, and it has a small opening, and you put the line that you want to look at, like the hydrogen alpha line, and you get that in the center, you close the little door, and you want it to be right over that line. If it's not, that's okay. Then you could adjust, turn the little knob down there. When it's on bam, it'll just pop in front of your face. I mean, you'll see it. Okay, this is what it looks like when you're looking at the spectrum live. Now, this is the second order. And this is a sunspot going through. I'm moving the disk of the sun around on the entrance slit. You can see how it's distorting the lines. You'll see some Doppler shift. You'll see little dark areas going up and down. Probably filaments on the sun, dark areas. And you'll see the kind of the lighter part, the penumbra. You'll see some kind of light color stuff going on through here. So there's some plage and stuff around sunspots. You'll see it get bright a few times there. You can see how it wiggles around. You see all this going on. When I was doing this, I had to have the red filter on it because I'm in the second order and there's some overlap. So you see a lot of detail. And then there's a lot of 99, 2000, 2001. A lot of stuff there, dark. And a lot of times you can see there's an umbra, the penumbra, and the penumbra you'll see some spectral lines also. So there's a lot of stuff going on that I don't understand. You can see how it's cutting across sideways. So it's just moving up and down. All this activity. There's nothing boring about it, at least to me. And and the sun is dynamic. All kinds of stuff going on all the time with it. And when you don't think anything's going on, you could look at it, and usually something will be happening. But the sunspots, it's just really exciting. So let's see. I guess I could go on to the next one here so we can see that. Okay, an H and K lines. So here we are, sunspot down the line. You can see the high area in there. You'll see a little change in this. But they have what they call, if you look at a profile chart, I have some up here. It's spread way out, and you can see how dark it gets out in this area and out over, the other side also. But it's hard to tell. They both look the same. They both behave the same. But that's the ancient canyon. I'll go ahead and go on to the next one. But you can see what it's doing now. You see a difference. How it's flashing. Almost like the lightning last night. I video that. But to me, this is, I like this. So dynamic. Okay, we'll go on to this one. Okay, you'll see some promises. Well, you know, this is a prominence. And then part of the spectrum of the sun is that washed out area. This area here, that's just kind of ambient light you see above. This is a fairly large prominence, and we'll get to it eventually. And what I'm doing is I'm cutting through sections of it, so it looks like there's different layers, but I'm actually moving the sun, and it's seeing different heights, different positions. So it almost looks like a flame sometimes, depending on the style of it. It'll go into the nodding mirror part, and then you'll see what we're looking at. I kind of got angry with myself when I was watching this, and I was saying, hurry up, do something different. See, but you're seeing it for the first time, so maybe it won't bother you like it. Yeah, it's kind of kicking myself, you know. Pardon me. It is. Yeah, you'll see. Okay, I close the exit slip, and it'll start vibrating. You'll see what happens. Gotta get it. So, see what happens? This kind of tells you how the nodding mirror system works, what it does, what it allows you to see, and what you're looking at. There was another prominence on there that was a little smaller, and I think I got that. And I also changed the gain on the camera so you could see a little bit of the disk of the sun. But what's fun is you could control the bandwidth just by moving the hydrogen alpha line. You could tune it on band, off band. You saw some of the disk of the sun when I tuned it a little differently. When I changed, now there's the other one on the other side. So when you have the spectrum, just the spectrum showing with the hydrogen alpha line, if you move the disk of the sun around and you go by a prominence, you'll see it off the end of the hydrogen alpha line, like it's going into space. Okay. We'll see what happens. Go on to the next one. Oh, we can see something. Well, I don't know if that's an artifact. We'll go to the next one. This will be the H alpha line at first order. So it looks a little darker. But you can see. There's two. Oh, yeah, here we go. Barrel hole in the screen. Yeah. Okay, there's a strong sunspot. You can see the pinnacle between the two of them. There probably could two spots in the same pinnacle. You'll see light areas going through. This is a little short, but it's kind of interesting. Okay, so on that, it's good. Okay, now helium and absorption and emission. Helium's off to the side of the sodium lines. You'll see that the helium is over here. It'll show up. Yeah. See it? It's a little dark area above and below. I'll keep this off of it, and you'll see some bright areas eventually. That's kind of a rare treat. The magnetic field has to be really strong. There has to be some really hot areas for this to happen. You can see the emission. Right there, where it's hot, the absorption. without a sense bar, you don't even see the line there. It's not visible. I don't forget the reason for it, but you don't see that. I thought that was kind of neat. So I spent time imaging that. You can see how it's affecting these lines here. It's making them get wider. But that's, you can tell it's a strong magnetic field. If I were down in the green now at this point, the line that I like to see, you would see this thing split for sure. There we are. That's a very rare sign. At least, I guess it is. For me, it was. So, I'm going to keep going a little bit. Okay, let's go on again. Okay, this is how you do it on the limit assignment. I showed you one, but this one. Okay. That's how helium looks on the limit assignment. And it's hard to get that sun if you don't have a system to track it really that great. Okay. All right. Here's places it's been. Quite a few. 10. I didn't even put the solar fest on here. It's up here. So you can see. This is Riverside Telescope Makers. A lot of you probably have you been. How many have been to Riverside? It's on the west coast. That's one of the big ones. I took this there over 11 years in a row after I got the award for it. I felt obligated to take it. I've never looked through another one yet. So I was invited to go to Arizona Flagstaff area, and I met a Dr. Knighty, that's his name. And this is Bill Kelly here. And a friend of mine went with me, Jim Wiggins is his name, and we stayed at his home. What a nice person he was. He and his wife treated us really well. So Red Rock State Park in Arizona, stayed there. This is at the Hale Solar Lab in Pasadena. That's Don Nicholson, a friend of Ron Kay, that's me. This is Shirley Bonas, that's her father. There are other people there. There's really hot and humid, just like it is here. This is the Hale Solar Lab in Pasadena. So in that area, this is a historic little place now. And it was owned by somebody that was related to Hale, but now it's not. I don't know if they could even go there anymore. This is Norm K. May. Remember I asked, do you remember that garage where George L. Hale's Spectrohelioscope was set up? This is a garage, but the doors have been changed a little bit. The holes. So there's a little history in that. This is a friend of mine, Blake Bartosh. He set up the visit down here. So Don Nicholson took me on a tour of Mount Wilson. We went down in the basement of the 100 inch and saw some of the lockers that the astronomers used. It opens up a lot of doors, a lot of opportunity. This is Mount Wilson, and Larry Webster, this gentleman here, was the head solar observer, and Don wanted him to see it. Larry is busy all the time. He'd climb up here and move the ceiling staff around from noon. And so I had this old 91 Dodge pickup, and I showed him parts of it. Eventually he came to Riverside, and he looked through it, and had a good time. My wife and I went there years ago, heard this commotion going on at the bottom of the solar thing. I knew somebody was in there, and I rattled the gate a little bit, and out he walked. I didn't know, and he invited us in, so he showed me down inside where the imaging was done. So, and I drew on the board the plan that I had for the spectrohelioscope. These are Anderson prisms. This was used on the snow. Telescope at Mount Wilson. And you can see they're not very big. That's the way Webster's hand, right there. They're probably not more than a half inch, or maybe a little less even. They're elongated, and these things, I guess, are just to keep you from bumping into it. There's one here and one over here. That's another way of synthesizing the sun on the entrance slit instead of a nodding mirror. You can shine a light through the prism has its vein while sweeping across the entrance slit. There's other ways of doing it too. Fred Veal has written, I brought one of his books that he gave him, he and I have become really good friends, Joe Perry. Brought me over. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Joe. He offered to bring me. This is at the Golden State Star Party in California. So you could see the sea clamps and stuff. So I was experimenting with the coelestone system. It's at a plateau about 4,000 feet high in the northeast part of California. Cattle ranch. The skies are just unbelievable. You know where you are? This is the SolarFest. Okay. Jim Kissick, who's born 1910, he gave me one of those tools. And so I bought another one. That never changed. I'm always going to use it. Wonderful man. And my wife painted the sun on the bell. So that's it. Thank you.